So we've had five sessions so far. We've thought about what are the things in advance of climate change, what are the kind of resiliencies we need to have, what are the geographic issues we need to be thinking about, what does the IPCC report say, what does the federal agenda look like, what does the state agenda and the city agenda look like. But one of the people that I, three of the people I think who have thought very much about what we do as we go forward rather than looking backward. I'm going to tell a quick story about each of the three people up here. One is I'm thrilled to have Dr. Mindy Fullilove. Not only is she a person that's thought very deeply about population movement, removal, impacts on disadvantaged and populations, but Mindy's also a psychiatrist. I remember talking to Mindy when I was at CDC about a week after September 11th, and Mindy said, you know, folks are set up for profound PTSD, and she was thinking about post-traumatic stress disorder and how we'd manage it. And the individual psychiatrist would think, well, we just need to see one person at a time, all 25 million of us who are 250 million traumatized by September 11th, and we'll deal with this. And Mindy was one of the few people I talked to who was thinking about how do we deal with post-traumatic stress disorder at a public health level. And so I'm looking forward to your new book about the impact, and you were kind enough to join me at the Tisch Studios for thinking about the physical environment, the mental environment, the social environment after major traumas. The next person is one of the newest members of the Institute of Medicine of the United States, and I think probably one of the youngest that's ever been elected, Dr. Nirav Shah. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Shah is a UCLA public health graduate, among other things, and is the New York State health officer, has remarkable experience in a very short time in New York State. I got quite an immersion as you got here, Nirav. And the state has had to think a lot about these impacts, both in the past, responding, and in the future. So thank you for being here. And the last person is an honorary American Institute of Architects member who I met behind the curtain. You always wonder what's going on behind the curtain. The American Institute of Architects meeting. Jonathan Rose is, I don't want to know if you were the designer, but at least the person behind Via Verata, if I'm saying it correctly.
Via Verde.
Via Verde, I'm sorry. And it's been shown in many settings as maybe a way of thinking about affordable housing that brings comfort, beauty, connection, and community.
I'm going to think out loud a second, but I think Mindy,
you think a lot about what's going on in the individual as they face the trauma of dislocation, relocation, both mentally and physically. And maybe it would make sense to start and think about the individual move up to the smaller, the block, the neighborhood, the home, etc. And for Jonathan and Terry, you jump in too. And then at the more macro level that Dr. Shah has to deal with as the state health director, which is a huge responsibility, commissioner, I guess you call it here. Would that be okay with you, Mindy?
Sure. But I think that it's impossible to talk about the issues facing the individual without also talking a little bit about the larger social structures within which the individual is embedded. There are two things that I think are really pressing as we think about climate change. The first is we're gonna move people, and moving people is tremendously difficult. And urban planners and many people minimize it, and it's just not true that it's nothing. That our home is our home. Whatever your home is, doesn't matter. Man's home is his castle. And moving people is extremely difficult, and it's a process that jars over the course of a really lifetime. So the people are gonna be moved off the coast. But this has to be done with great respect for the fact that this is not trivial in the experience of the person. But the second thing is that we have as a society been moving communities very freely. Anytime there's an urban problem, the answer is, oh, move the black people. So we had redlining, that was the answer to the bank collapse in the 1930s. which said, oh, don't invest where the black people live, that'll be a good idea. Then we had urban renewal in the neighborhoods that weren't invested in. Then we had deindustrialization, which of course affected the whole society, but African Americans were never helped to move into the new sectors of employment, so they remained underemployed and at great risk. Then we have had planned shrinkage and de facto planned shrinkage, and then gentrification and foreclosure crisis, both of which hit African American communities and are hitting very hard. These are not isolated events in the lives of individuals and communities, but upheavals and disruptions that have torn social structures, the same social structures, over and over and over again. So how does that relate to climate change? I think it relates to climate change in a couple of ways. The people who are going to be most brutally moved are the same people. So public housing in the Rockaways is, people are going to discover that they have to move off the coast, and it's going to be okay. It's going to be for their own good, because it's progress or whatever. That's the usual language. And it doesn't hurt. Or it's like a flu shot, it only hurts a little bit. And I think people conceptualize displacing African Americans as a flu shot. Like, they don't know how to behave, have a bad community, it's full of litter. So we'll give them this flu shot of displacing them and then it'll all be okay. And it is conceptualized by the rest of society as something that's happening to them over there and not something that's of any importance to the rest of society. So if climate change, we recognize ecology, sort of the effects of putting more carbon into the air, as an example, changing the ecosystem. The same applies for moving populations and moving populations over and over again. That these are ecological interventions, and they have effects on the whole of society. And the particular effect that we are seeing now is that it has contributed to the gross stratification and of our society, by both, which is both structured by race and class, and the dissolution of connections among the pieces, most dramatically when Congress shut down on October 1st, because the people on the left and the people on the right had lost the capacity to really talk to each other and negotiate with each other. But this is very general in our society. The people at the top live a different life from the people at the bottom. So along comes a catastrophe, and people need to work together. They need to think together. They need to understand some concepts that we've never really understood before. We need to understand regions. We need to understand ecosystems. And in fact, in the system that breaks people apart by race and class, it all rests on that being the logical assumption of how things work. So climate change asks us to make a completely different assumption about things work, that things are interconnected. One of the most dramatic times I ever saw this played out in the public space was after 9/11. Everybody went to Union Square, including all the people who didn't think we should go to war. And Giuliani shut it down after 2 weeks. All the posters, all the banners, all the things that I collected there were shut down. And that was really the last presence of everybody, of a free open space in that post 9/11 period. Because everybody was there, everybody in the city, like you needed to mourn, you went there. That was shut down. People had no way to contact each other. Giuliani was not a mayor of all people, he was a mayor of some. So, in fact, the Times yesterday had a very interesting article about de Blasio, that black people, 96% of African Americans voted for de Blasio and see him as their mayor. So after 20 years of not having a mayor that related to them, they now feel like someone represents them. Whether this will turn out to be true or not, we will see. But that's the hope. So, in sum, displacement is very difficult. Displacement has been practiced repeatedly on African Americans, leading to all of their problems, all the current problems of African American people can be traced back to repeated displacements. It will surely be done again in the name of climate change and progress. But if we as a society are going to respond to climate change, we're in a very poor position. In fact, we're in a very poor position to deal with any of our problems. Whatever the problem is, somehow the answer is move the black people. So that's not an ecological answer, but we have to break through that compartmentalized, racialized thinking if we're going to solve the problems of climate change. I think we're in a race with time on this one. So those are, and that worries me a lot.
I'm struck by, Mindy and I are old friends at this point, we've been working together for 20 plus years, but the need to be able to mourn in the face, as we look at the events that we've gone through as a society, and there's never given, not never, it's often very difficult to find that space, you know, just go back to work, everything will be fine, go shop some more, and America will be better. And would you speak to that a little bit as a psychiatrist, because I think it's a very rich vein.
By January 1st, they wanted people in New York, by January 1st, 2002, they wanted people in New York. So what does that do if you have this complete attenuation of the public's ability to articulate what's happened to itself? It's the same as, I think, any other personal process that's shut down. So if somebody loses a mother and it won't mourn, it stays as an undiagnosed psychic thing. Until you're ready to unpack it. And I say this because my discipline, which is social psychiatry, is really born in warfare. And the really entrenched warfare, you think about how do you keep people in the trenches, and think about all the psychological trauma of standing in water and dead bodies for weeks on end and moving inches forward. How do you do that? It's sort of, how do you keep people moving forward? On the one hand, you can't deny what people are going through, which is what we tend to do. But on the other hand, you have to understand that in a war, you have to keep going, you can't quit. So you're trying to keep the unit together, keep people working together. So it's finding that balance between saying, this is something where we have to work through together, we have to go together. Win the war, lose the war, to, you know, we'll hang together or we'll hang separate. So it's that getting that togetherness, but always an acknowledgement of what the difficulties are. And so that's the basic approach of social psychiatry to all of these kinds of situations. It's that what we learned in the trenches.
As the physicians in the room know, people aren't resilient when the various systems of the body are not working together. And in a way, the body politic, when the systems are so disaggregated and separated, in fact, being even more atomized, more centrifugal, there's no way we can respond as a society when we're just going in different directions. Mindy, you look puzzled.
There's a tendency that we have, but it's part of how we talk in public health, when we talk about disparities, to see those as a problem of people at the bottom. And I think more and more scholars are saying, look, this affects the whole society. So although I want to say, look, whenever there's a problem with the city, the answer is move the black people, this is a problem for the whole society. And this kind of thinking that the answer is move the black people is the same kind of thinking that's stopping us from looking at climate change and global warming. This atomization of how the world works, when in fact we have to see the unity of the whole. So I just really want to emphasize that this is not simply a problem of ill health among black people. Because we tend to go
there.
That's trying to say the opposite.
This is, we're going to ask Jonathan to jump in. Thank you very much for joining us today, Mr. Rose.
Thank you. So, although I'm going to talk primarily about America, I'm going to start in Ladakh. So Ladakh is high in the Himalayas, it's in the Tibetan Plateau. So Ladakh is a place that lives with enormous constraints. Its base elevation is 11,500 feet. It gets 3 inches of rainwater a year. And because its really water supply is dependent upon the melt of the Tibetan the glaciers, they're shifting, that's shifting. But they've devolved a culture for how to live well within an extremely environmentally constrained and now shifting environment. So there's a real lesson in that. And I'm going to get back into that more, because part of resilience is building spare capacity. It's building spare cognitive capacity at the individual level. It's building social capacity at the neighborhood and social interconnected level, at a larger societal level. And so surprisingly, you gain more often by designing systems that need less. Interestingly, in Ladakh, it's extremely connected during the summer. There are dozens, not dozens, but a handful of flights in and out every day, and a very active tourist world, which it provides 50% of the economy. The other 50% is agriculture, growing barley, etc. And then, literally, for 6 months of the year, the tourist industry goes away, the flights go away, and it's an isolated kingdom. With a very strong Buddhist culture. So they're spending 6 months of the year earning money, actively engaged, connected globally to the world, and 6 months of the year in retreat, in essence, and doing cultural renewal. It's a very interesting model. It's not one I think we can easily adapt to the West. So I happened to have dinner with the political leaders of Ladakh, and they really talked about how important that renewal and retreat time was for maintaining this healthy balance. And what Ladakh has done is, its only sources of energy are hydro and solar. It has, I first went there in 1984 when it was really making a choice about its path of development. And it's not perfect by any means, but it really tried to choose a path that was an integrated and one that used appropriate technology and that improved well-being while also maintaining the cultural resilience that they had. And maintaining the essence of the well-being, the kind of more religious well-being that they had. I raise that because what we're seeing in the world increasingly is this tension between prosperity and well-being, and that prosperity, which is so tied to consumption, is exacerbating climate change, exacerbating resource depletion, and in fact, prosperity, I view, in many cases, is the driver of decrease of well-being. So one of the questions as we get to the community level is how do we design places that are actually more resilient, less resource dependent, increase well, and that we focus on well-being as the outcome and not just prosperity as the outcome. Globally, I'll just, before I come back to locally, so we see an interesting thing where in the cities of Rio, the developing world, they're rapidly urbanizing by a very high density, poorly served, low infrastructure sprawl. as we move those people into modern towers, which describe and models something of what you've been talking about, Mindy, we completely disconnect them from community. We also disconnect them from livelihood. So what we call the informal economy, or even the illegal economy, is the economy of low-income people throughout the world. And when you just put them in towers like out at the Far Rockaways, the income, all the income producing, social connecting producing, frothiness of what may be unhealthy, unsafe, and illegal communities, but has been sterilized. And I think stunts the growth of those people and their social systems to move forward. How do we plan for an uncertain future? So the first thing is there is a interesting movement that's come out of Germany called the passive house movement. Now I'm going to talk about it at the building level. And passive houses use about 20% of the energy of a normal building. And this is in a cold climate like Germany and Northern Europe. So the way they do it is a very old way. So it's with insulation, thermal mass, building cavity walls with air spaces in them, using high performance glass. So it's a building that is naturally tuned to nature. It has sunshade so that in the winter the sun comes in and warms, in the summer the sun is left out. It cools itself with natural ventilation. These buildings kind of take care of themselves. If we can cut the global energy demand by 80% in our buildings, because our buildings are designed with nature to be naturally self-balancing, that does an enormous amount of things. It not only solves part of the whole climate change issue, but for the occupants, whether they are owners like, in Terry's, in my world, low-income community development corporations, or they're the individuals who are renting and paying electric bills and utility bills in their apartments, low-income people, if those costs go down, shrink to 20%, then that gives them a little more space in the rest of their economic budgets. I just give you this as one example. The people of Ladakh are living very happily and growing agriculture on 3 inches of rain a year by really carefully husbanding that water and recycling it and using it. But we're seeing the oldest continuously operating water recycling system.
that actually takes sewer water, cleans it up, and puts it back in the drinking water supplies in Namibia, is the capital of Namibia, in Windhoek. And it's been entirely safe for over 35 years. So part of the problem of the go shopping is the consumption. Consumption is I'm suggesting, is exactly entirely the wrong solution. And that the way we will create more well-being in a time of both volatility that climate change brings and uncertainty and constraints is the security of living well with less. That gives us spare, just as the Ladakhis have this cognitive spare room in the winter to regenerate their culture and their minds. So we need on the physical resource side. The second thing is that so we live in this world of uncertainty, and we know that so we're not only going to have more storms that knock out power, we're going to have more heat waves, and we know that I believe heat waves kill 10 times more people than water-based storms do. So the heat wave of Chicago, etc., heat waves in Europe, heat waves are incredibly deadly, and the best solution are social systems towards solving that. We're going to have power outages because the way our grids are interconnected and are so out of date. It is very likely that we're going to have cyber attacks that are going to increasingly just take down our systems as our systems become more interconnected, as we use big data and urban systems to manage everything more. So, and one of my latest fears is if you read the current issue of Foreign Affairs, 4D printing, so 3D printing is printing 3D objects, 4D printing is printing objects that have, or printing DNA, so things that can evolve over time, and the ability of 4D printing now to create all kinds of terrible viruses and infect the world, etc. So there's enormous volatility, uncertainty, and vulnerability coming ahead. So I'm going to go back to this Ladakh example, which is, so we live in a hugely interconnected world, and what Mindy talked about earlier is how the failure to have healthy and whole and diverse connections undermines the health of the system. But at the same time, increased connectivity makes the system more vulnerable. So my view is we have to design everything to go on what I call the manual mode. So for example, if we put in digital signaling systems in the subway system and really advanced car management, we can increase the throughput of our current subway system by 30%. It can carry 30% more passengers without having to build a new line, just through better management. But when the power goes out, we have not designed the subway system to run on manual. It stops. We actually need to think about, at the same time as we enter in this much more vulnerable world, how everything, so if it only runs at 20% capacity because it's all on manual, then maybe there's guys with walkie-talkies or flashlights or however they're running the subway system, but we need that alternative manual backup. So now let's go to the building level. So if you have a passive house building that is only using 20% of the electricity needed, or the fuel energy needed, then you can provide solar power, batteries, and a generator system that can continue the essential services of that building for a very long period of time. We run generators 24 hours a day, and because of that, if our fuel supply is disrupted, eventually they run out. But if they're charging batteries and there's a solar system, they may only need to run 2 or 3 hours a day. So you can get incredible extended life. So I think we need to, so another thing to think about our buildings is, what if they all had at least one or two showers on the ground floor? What if they had, so what are some of the things that buildings can be done to design to allow them to function better in the crisis mode? And then let us take this to a larger level, which are communities. And what I think we really need are what I'm calling community resilience centers. So imagine if you took local healthcare centers, or maybe it's a school, maybe it's a church, maybe it's a library, and you said we're going to equip them with enough bathrooms to serve the community, even if there's lines when the showers, places to recharge. If they had the knowledge centers for how to rebuild, how to respond, they became the places of information for distribution of resources, etc. So how important social networks and social systems are to creating community resilience. So such a physical community resilience, if married with the social infrastructure and funding for community capacity building could be built with social networks of resilience. So we have the hardware and software of resilience in every neighborhood. And if those centers were then connected so they could, into a network so they could share best practices and ideas, and you could kind of flow through a state, for example, a whole system of hardware and software of social resilience to allow us to be more adaptable.
So all the things you're talking about, I don't see how you ever make any money or make a living, and nobody's really, this will never be operationalized in the real world, John.
I thought it
I'm teasing you a little bit, because I want you to talk about Via Verde a little bit.
So Via Verde is a housing project. It's in a mixed income housing project in the South Bronx. It was the Sean Donovan, when he was the commissioner of housing in New York, said, I want to figure out what's the next model of green affordable housing. And so we began to, and there was a competition. So we put together a team, we're competing for it. And one of the problems with competitions, I'm very skeptical of competitions because you work in isolation. And the best housing development is done in collaboration with the community. It's a real feedback system, and that was, we were not allowed to talk to the community in this process because it was all supposed to be, you know, like everybody competing in equal ground. But we all got to go to one public meeting, and at the public meeting, we heard community residents talk about what they wanted, and one of the things they said is they wanted jacuzzis. So I heard that differently. What I heard is they said they wanted health and well-being. I mean, I said, why do people want jacuzzis? What is that really, what are they really asking for? So we conceived of differently than our competitors, Via Verde, as not only being a building that was this latest in green strategy and energy conservation, but also in health and well-being. So on the ground, so it's a beautiful, very architecturally beautiful, it's won dozens of awards. Last Friday, it won the global, Urban Land Institute's global best development of the year award. So on the ground floor, it has a branch of Montefiore Hospital and a pharmacy. It has a children's, very safe and closed children's play area. It has different little neighbors. It has a, and then, remember I mentioned that whole idea of retreat. So we have a series of public spaces. So this is a model for how in a very tight urban, high density space, you have higher density and higher open space. So at the very top of the building on the 20th floor where the best views are is the community room. And coming off of that then are more private spaces, more contemplative spaces. As you move down the building, so all, it's a series of steps that go from very high in the north to low in the south so the sunlight comes in. And as it steps down, there are a series of increasingly public green roofs. So the first one is really a place for doing yoga and reading and meditating, and is tied into the exercise room. And then it goes down to a community garden that grows food collectively for the whole building. One of the interesting things we do is instead of saying everybody gets a little plot for themselves, we say everybody works together for everybody. And then that leads to an orchard, and then that leads to an amphitheater where community events are held. So the we did things like we moved the stairwells to the exterior and daylit them so as to encourage people to walk. There's a whole series of physical, so the physical infrastructure is designed to support the social infrastructure of community, of health, of interaction. The building is a mixture of low-income rental and moderate-income home ownership, co-ops. So it's got a, we also think that healthy communities have an income mix to them. And the community has become, so the building is winning all these awards because it's so architecturally beautiful, and it's so green, and it's a, but that's not what really matters. What matters is the community of the residents is astounding. The quality of life and being and the sensibility of being, everybody moved in and realized they were privileged to arrive at a special place. But they responded by saying, and so we're going to build a special community. And that's what's so amazing about this place. And the vibe is such that it is a low and moderate income community that almost every high income person I know who visits it says, I want to live here.
How do you anticipate it'll stand up to a 21st century climate with more energy and moisture in the atmosphere and this sort of, that realm of threat?
So the building, so first of all, it's got a lot of solar. It has enough solar to actually run the core and shell elements. We designed it as a thinner building than normal, so that the units have a lot of windows. It's got sun shading, so it's got all the passive heating and cooling that I described. It also has, because heat is going to be the bigger problem in cooling as the 21st century goes on. So everything's designed for cross ventilation. Every single unit has at least two exposures, and many of them, about half of them are duplexes. The living room, dining room, kitchen over here, and the bedrooms over there, so the air goes up and through and out. So I actually think by the way, it captures all its rainwater to use to water the gardens. It captures all of its organic waste to use to fertilize the gardens. So you never get it right. It's got a lot of the right things. What I hope is that we have the DNA of the community that will continue to evolve the way the building is lived and worked, so that the culture, in effect, culture is a significant part of our adaptation to climate change and other variability. And what I think we have the seeds of an adaptive culture. We're now just open a project in Philadelphia called Paseo Verde. We work all over the country, which is a more horizontal model of exactly this mixed use, mixed income healthcare provider in the ground floor, green roofs, et cetera. So there are many ways in which these concepts can manifest. But actually, I mean, maybe turn to Terry. So what happened about 10 years ago is I was working with Enterprise Community Partners on the idea of how do we take the greenness of buildings to scale? And Enterprise created this amazing program called the Green Communities Program, which has created both a guideline, a system, a training system, a funding system, et cetera, that has really scaled so that of all the systems in America, affordable housing will be the first to go 100% green in new construction. You think it should have been schools, it should have been hospitals, it could have been churches and synagogues and mosques. It could have been luxury housing. I mean, think about who would have thought that affordable housing would have been first, but it's going to go green first because of Enterprise. It completely changed the system of how, of new development. The existing is much harder. Our company is also working on that. We actually have an investment fund with Citibank that buys existing affordable housing and greens it and tries to make it more resilient. And we've had some successes. I'm learning a huge amount about what all the impediments are.
This is an amazingly rich set of discussions. I'm a little worried. Dr. Shah got very early to come down from Albany this morning, and I want to make sure that he gets this time to speak, and then we're going to open up the dialogue for all of us, because this is very different thinking from traditional urban planning, traditional public health, traditional medical care, traditional housing. This is a big shift. So, Nirav, thank you very much. It's an honor to have you here.
My pleasure. I'll take what you lobbed me and start off. You know, we know, for example, in healthcare, out of our $2.7 trillion that we spend every year as a nation, we're not getting our money's worth. That a third of that money is wasted, and things like supportive housing could be a boon. It is outside of the healthcare delivery system, and so it's unfunded. But in New York, for example, we have committed hundreds of millions of dollars in supportive housing, where we know in the Medicaid program there are today about $1 billion of Medicaid dollars spent on folks who would benefit from supportive housing. This is annual, where today Medicaid pays $755 a day for an inpatient stay, $450 a day for an inpatient psychiatric stay, about $300 a day for a nursing home stay, about $129 for a day in jail, about $68 for a homeless shelter, and $48 a day if we only had supportive housing units for these folks, which is basically housing plus a little substance abuse treatment, a little mental health services or other services in the same place. We requested $1 billion from the feds to build supportive housing, and they've said no because they don't know how to build or pay for bricks and mortar out of their healthcare budget. So they do figure out how to pay for it in the nursing home space. They haven't figured out in the supportive housing space. But what I wanted to turn to and talk about more was about, with climate change, what I've learned. And you talked a little bit about the hardware and the software of resilience. And we've inherited the hardware that we have. Our hospitals and our nursing homes are what we got for them. But in the course of Sandy last year, exactly a year ago, there were three massive failures that didn't happen. And it happened, they didn't happen because of the software of resilience. And so I think we'll bridge some of the earlier talks with this. The software of resilience is the social capital. The social capital. We initially, as Sandy hit, we realized that there were, in zone A, in the slosh zone, there were about 52 facilities that were at high risk. Obviously, we tried to staff up those facilities. We mandated 3 days of food. We mandated 150% staff. We tried to decant them to the best of our ability, but we had to keep in touch with them. And so we knew who knew those facilities. We deployed portable radios. We did whatever we had to stay in touch. But we realized that there were so many people getting in touch in different ways. We needed one system to talk to each other about what's going on in all these 50 facilities in nearby. So on the fly, I created a Google Doc that I opened up to the city OEM, Linda Gibbs. Everyone had access to it who needed it from the state and city level, with each of the facilities named, with the last time of contact, the person last contact, the method of contact, status updates, number of residents, number of staff, other issues related to food, medication, et cetera. Just a long, ugly spreadsheet that everyone could look at in real time from Albany, from New York City, from their home. So when a facility went down and the only way someone could get through was a text message from someone who knew someone, we could still communicate with that facility in real time because we all knew how to get to that facility. And so we could monitor those 50-some facilities in real time and ultimately evacuated over 7,100 patients from 8 hospitals that closed and numerous nursing homes without a single person dying. There was one person who slipped and fell and broke a limb. But that happened because we had the connections enabled by technology in that area to know what's happening across anyone who had any connection to that facility. A second failure that should have happened was with dialysis patients. There was extensive outages of power. Clean water was not accessible in many parts of the city, but you couldn't predict exactly where that happened. There was a large dialysis facility in Manhattan, in the southern part of Manhattan, that lost power. 600 patients. We knew that we were going to have problems. We didn't know where they were going to be. Same thing. Most facilities, 2 or 3 dialysis machines, they have excess capacity, but how do you connect and coordinate all of that? Well, the answer is, you probably could if you thought about it a long time ago. But the reality was, they already were connected. They had social networks of their own. So on Sunday, before Sandy hit on Monday, on Sunday, when dialysis facilities were usually closed, they all opened up. They all dialyzed patients in advance. So that when there was downtime the next few days, people had some capacity in the system. And then they called each other up. We certainly facilitated phone calls as a state, getting to all the providers saying, are you open? Do you have clean water? Do you have power? Do you need a generator? What do you need? But a lot of it happened organically. And it was the social capital where competitors were taking patients from each other because they were open, taking care of them, using their own transportation networks, figuring it out for the greater good, and then eventually giving those patients back when the other company did open. That happened because of the social capital in the dialysis community. A third example is in the Park Slope Armory. The Park Slope Armory housed about 650 people for over a month. These are people who were evacuated from nursing homes, from supportive housing, from many other areas. And it was a huge, I don't know if you've seen it, it's a huge open space where they, there's no privacy, there's few bathrooms, there's, it's, you know, no showers. And here you have hundreds of people who are disoriented, taken out of nursing homes, out of their familiar surroundings, and put there and told to live there for a month or longer. Some lasted a lot longer. Well, it worked because, first of all those nursing home patients came with their ward attendants, with their nurses. These people, some of these nurses have lost their own homes, and yet they came with their patients and they tried to recreate the settings and the groupings of patients so that they wouldn't be as disoriented. When we needed kosher meals in an emergency, one of the local politicians just tweeted, "We need kosher meals at Park Slope Armory." And suddenly the community responded. And before we could get our frozen, we do have a large stock of kosher frozen meals at the state, just so you know. Before we could deploy them, the community came out with kosher meals, real hot meals in real time, and solved that problem before it even became a problem. There was in one corner when Sebelius visited, live music. Local musicians would come and just play, and there would be a few people just sitting around and listening. It was better than any nursing home I've ever visited. There was a horrible potential problem with infection, where, you know, little one case of diarrhea gone amok, it could have been a nightmare. And yet, because of the social networks of the physicians who knew other HHC, Health and Hospitals Corporation doctors, Coney Island had been shut down, there's a lot of unemployed doctors waiting around. Those infection control people from the hospitals came and started making big signs on how to prepare food, how to wash your hands properly, where to dispose of things, how to cover things up. Not rocket science, but again, the community responded to the needs of the people in real time and cut off a problem before it even happened. It could never have been orchestrated that way. No central command and control incident response system could have said, we need you to get kosher meals, we need you to do infection control, we need you to bring live music, we need you to fill the other needs of these people. But it was the social capital of the communities that really made all the difference. And we know this. We know this from in Tokyo in 1923 when a fire swept 95% of the districts. The places that responded the best, the ones that came back, were the ones that had the most protests, the ones that voted the most, the ones that had evidence of connections and social capital across the system. So when we, as a healthcare delivery system, look at what's out there, we don't have money to build things. We don't have money to really invest in other ways. We can invest at low cost and potentially high yield in the capacities of social capital, in the electronic versions of it, whether it's Facebook and Twitter and Instagram or whatever, or other networks that can lead to the kind of resilience we need when we will be faced with our next Sandy or Irene. I want to leave a lot of time for discussion, so I'll stop there.
I have a question. It's a wonderful story. I was wondering, why do you think it worked so well this time, as opposed to, say, like the Chicago heat wave, where people just died alone in their apartments, nobody checking on them? Was it sort of a collective understanding of the magnitude of this disaster? Do you think there was kind of, this is different from a heat wave in that people understood collectively that this was a great problem? Just curious about
I can't emphasize enough the role of exercises and planning from a state perspective. When you go through and do an exercise of what will happen if there's a 20-foot wave, and you physically sit in the room with everyone else, and you go through the exercise, you know, if nothing else, who the other person is that you can call. Who else is going to be around the table? When it was 4 in the morning, I had an emergent call from one of the places, one of the shelters. We need 800 adult diapers. Stat. That was a real emergency. Because they moved all these nursing home patients, they didn't move the diapers with them. So I could call the Michael Dowling, the head of North Shore LIJ, and he could send 3 ambulances full of adult diapers because I have a cell phone and I know who to call. So those kinds of connections, even at every level, you know, people on the front lines could call me because I was a Bellevue doc and say, this is what's going on in Bellevue, you need to get someone down here. And I could send one of my fellows to physically be my eyes on the ground so that we don't have that vast gulf between the people who have the resources and the people who are dealing with the end result. During Irene, a year before, Tropical Storm Lee and Irene, about 10,000 nursing homes evacuated, right? Because that was a different decision at that time about sheltering in place versus evacuation. About a month before that, we had published on our website, on an open API platform, all of the nursing home bed census data, the weekly nursing home bed census data. Most boring data set there is, right? How many beds there are, how many beds are empty. Well, when Irene hit on a weekend, the Department of Health is closed, those nursing home operators who knew about it, which was everyone, went to the website, saw where there were vacancies, and moved their patients out of harm's way into other nursing homes on their own. So to the extent that we can get out of the way by facilitating the sharing of information and ultimately knowledge, that's a big role for government. And one of the most important things that the governor has done has been creating the open.ny.gov website, where you have literally thousands of data sets, everything from parks to taxes to health, on seemingly innocuous data. It's ultimately available at your fingertips in real time, geocoded, you know, whatever you need. And now we're building on that platform, apps and other things. So we're democratizing all this information that only we used to hold. So you can do whatever you want with it. Maybe you can use it, maybe you can't. Someone else might use it a different way. That's part of the response.
So I just want to add, so democratizing this information, and the information can be used for good or evil. I mean, I presume somebody could, anyway, it could be used in many ways. So it really requires us to have a common set of ethics about how we use data, what is the purpose of society, government, and that we're all kind of committed. What you heard about all this is all this emergent behavior that's altruistic and negative. So we need to keep planting the seeds of altruistic motivation too. I think that's a when you don't have enough altruism, then societies tend to move towards rigidity, control, and fascism. And so I think altruism is an enormous antidote, or a necessary component that goes with openness.
I agree with you, but I think in those disasters, I saw incredible altruism. You know, docs climbing up giant buildings, making sure that every patient had insulin who needed it, or whatever it was. Oxygen patients had new tanks. Workers who needed to get to home care on Manhattan and didn't have gas were let through and somehow they got fuel. Again, it didn't happen because of us, it happened despite us. There was a lot happening because I think that the disasters brought out the good in many people.
Some person was on the other end of the country both during Katrina and Sandy and watching. I remember sitting and watching with my family, including my mother-in-law, what was going on in New Orleans, and everyone had the same emotion. It wasn't so much sorrow, and I felt a lot of sorrow for people. We were all angry. This is not my country. What is going on here? And we didn't have that emotion as we watched Sandy. We felt sorrow, and frankly, I don't think most Americans grasped the magnitude of Sandy. The media, for some reason, you didn't get a sense of how enormous it was. It wasn't until I got here and began to travel around, realize how immense it was. But none of us had anger. And I just wonder if you'd reflect on that. Maybe the psychiatrist might want to reflect on that a little bit as well.
If you think about Katrina and Sandy, it's the sort of opposite ends of the spectrum. You have to assume the same amount of altruism in the face of a disaster exists in New Orleans as exists in the New York metropolitan area. But we can, so how do we get to the decisions that abandon people? who gets abandoned and how we take that seriously. Because it's, you know, it's you can't assume the benevolence of government. In Katrina, we saw the non-benevolence of government. I completely agree that this social fabric, the social psychiatrist, we think it's everything. But we also think that things like racism rip it in ways that make it much weaker than it should be. And in a crisis, you can see both the altruism of people, but also the weakness of the structure. So, Dick, I really remember feeling that this is not my country, just that it was just gross to see what had abandoned.
Yeah, I have to tell the story of Bellevue because it was incredible. Two patients left in Bellevue. Bellevue Hospital, down. No power. Generators on the 13th floor. National Guard carrying 5-gallon drums of fuel up 13 flights of stairs because two patients who couldn't be evacuated. One was a woman too large for the elevator, and the elevators were broken. And the other was a 38-year-old man who had a right ventricular assist device and a left ventricular assist device. I mean, his heart was basically being worked on by the machines. The Air Force came in and built a mobile operating room around that cardiac patient on the 14th floor. It looked like a real operating room, and took out one of the devices so they could evacuate. Days and days of National Guard. I went with someone who was in uniform to visit, and as we climbed up, these National Guard are collapsed on the ground, and they would snap to attention because she was in uniform. Unbelievable. The spirit there for two patients, what they did for a week keeping that hospital open versus what happened in Katrina. It's point counterpoint. It's really incredible.
Social psychiatry cares about morale. We think it's really critical in these kinds of situations. And I think that in New York City, the increasing disparities of wealth and the kind of Giuliani Bloomberg years of this period of concentration of wealth and the sort of people at the top, the elites, really, you know, having all the limelight, and then the problems of the poor just kind of fading, that the whole concept that there was 99%, we were in the 99%, and that the 1% of the people had taken all the money, which everybody just articulated something that everybody was feeling. Like, wait, I used to have a little money. I used to have a pension plan. I used to have whatever. I used to have something. Now I have
beach house.
I used to have a beach house. Right? This articulation that wait, I'm suffering. I didn't think I was supposed to be suffering. And isn't everything great? No, it's not a party yet. It opened up a space for discussion of what was happening. And then I think there's no question that the organization that went on, in the actual Occupy, did exactly what Dr. Shah is talking about in terms of people meeting each other, having each other's phone numbers, knowing how to get in touch with each other, so that a whole group of people was easily able to connect and be of help. And they went to be of help in out of the way places that could have been forgotten and abandoned. And so they immediately went to the Rockaways and to Redmond. So to Coney Island and shone a spotlight on those issues. So I think that, not to say they were the only ones who went, but they did go right away and they made a lot of noise. Mm-hmm. And I think that helped. And they certainly were stories at different times when they were the only ones there. So I think that both, it lifts morale when you say, wait a minute, the dissent is very important in a democracy for keeping people feeling hopeful. So like, wait a minute, they took all my money, and we have money. It's a really good thing to have going on. And then people being connected, that's those social networks, so that they could go and their sense of like, wait, let's go to the most disadvantaged places and help out.
Jonathan, the story of Villa Verde, Terry, how do we scale this up? How can we use the muscle of the medical and the healthcare system? How can we use the muscle of some of these other social systems we talked about? How can we use the threat of climate change to take something that seems, at least to an outsider, eminently reasonable. It's viable for the people who are living there. It's viable in the face of climate change. It's economically and health viable. How do we scale this up at a much larger level?
So the affordable housing system is entirely subsidized. It's a mixture of public and private, but it can only come through the subsidies, and we need more of them. And in the past, we focused on just generating a certain number of units. Like, creating the housing units was the outcome. And now what I think we're recognizing is creating the healthy lives is the outcome. And therefore, if we can tie the housing system together with the healthcare system and use the preventative savings, capitalize the preventative savings, that would be enormously impactful.
How do we assure, particularly in this hardware, software, social capital, financial capital's world of a disaster, how does government make sure that we add value and keep things functional and we don't get in the way? And we've all been in the situation where a set of government rules, you know, you can't give those people that food because it hasn't been refrigerated for the last 8 hours. I'm making this up, but so often government ends up being an obstacle in these kind of informal systems rather than a facilitator.
I mean, for me, it's really been about common sense. Just making decisions. I think that's been one big deal, that government has a hard time making decisions in general. Because if you make a decision, you'll upset some people, and you'll make some people happy. Not being a politician, not knowing any better, and still being a doctor that's licensed and I can go back to Bellevue and work, just making decisions. Yes, deliver them adult diapers. Yes, feed them, you know, that food. Yes, get the kosher meals because they're kosher and they'll actually eat them even though they're in the community and whatever. Making decisions has been a big part. But the other thing that has really been my true north is focusing on what people really want. And it's health. And it's not health care. When you start defining that people want health, not health care, all the questions you ask change and the answers change. And for me, repeatedly saying, how does this increase health? How does this improve value? How does this relate to outcomes? Makes me be able to speak in the language of bankers, and I can give you numbers for supportive housing, or, you know, I can give you numbers for public health. A dollar on water fluoridation saves you $14 in taxpayer dollars in Medicaid, in children's dental bills, or a dollar in the Nurse Family Partnership Program saves us $5.70 in juvenile justice and education costs, and you know, I can go on, because I understand that people think about money a lot, and that if you start to approach them in language that they're comfortable with, that they're used to, that actually whether they're red state, blue state, Republican, Democrat, they'll get it, and they'll do the right thing. Maybe not for the right reasons, but they'll do the right things if you talk to them in the language that they understand.
My father was a union organizer. One time he was organizing out of town, at sort of the end of the day, a bunch of guys were gathered in a hotel room, and they were having a drink and some food and laughing and telling jokes, and the head of the union walked in, and they all were trying to pretend that they weren't doing what they were doing. And he was like, no, relax, isn't this what we're fighting for? So I think that's what we're fighting for, is that, you know, Jonathan talked about it as like a small space in which you could retreat and meditate or have a party or grow some vegetables. I don't think people don't actually need all the things we tell them they need. But they do need stability, and they need to know that there's solidarity, and they need to know that they could go on a walkabout if they need to. Which seems contradictory, stability and walkabout. Do people need to I need to leave Dr. Shah here in charge, and then I go on walkabout. And that's what people need. So this is not impossible, but it requires some generosity of spirit. And it requires recognizing that all people are people, that this inherent worth and dignity of every person, there's no opt-out on that. It's not every person who's, except ones with a modifier, right? Like, but black people aren't people, so black people. That undermines possibility of all of this happiness for all of us. And that's the thing I think it's hardest to see, because we're so convinced by this apartheid thing that they're not people. Mm-hmm. That we don't see that if some people aren't happy, none of us are happy. So that's that I think is the huge obstacle. And I think to a certain extent, would push back on what Dr. Shah said, that if people will do the right thing, if you talk to them in the language they understand, my experience is slightly different, which is that until it comes to racism, and then they have an opt-out. So, and racism is, whatever it is. There are many isms where we opt out. So to deal with infectious diseases, unless they're killing gay people, which is useful to us. So how do we deal with that? And I've seen that happen over and over and over again in the 30 years I've been doing public health, that we opt out when it comes to the desirables. And there's no opt out. It's the inherent worth of dignity.